So maybe pick out a project that is something you can do. I mean, it's from cleaning the kitchen again to touching up paint, just all kinds of things. The tree out there has grown, so the school can't put the flag up anymore without it being torn. If somebody has a good chainsaw and a good ladder. I mean, we have a big ladder. We get somebody to hold it for you. We just need somebody to go up there and trim that tree so we can get the flag back up again. I mean, it's just little things. As they say, it takes a village. And many hands make light work. And I know not everybody can do everything, but maybe there's something everybody can do. So please put it in your schedule, 9 o'clock next Sunday. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Any other announcements this morning? If not, I'll turn it over to Bella. I'm out of sequence again. It's time for Paulette to have our morning prayer.
Good morning. I want to read this on the Holy Spirit here. It says, in the plan of restoring in men the divine image, it was provided that the Holy Spirit should move upon human minds and be as the presence of Christ, a molding agency upon human character. Receiving the truth, men become also recipients of the grace of Christ and devote their sanctified human ability to the work in which Christ was engaged. Men become laborers together with God. It is to make men agents for God, that divine truth is brought home to their understanding. But I would inquire of the church, have you answered this purpose? Have you fulfilled the design of God in diffusing the light of divine truth, in scattering abroad the precious jewels of truth? Let's pray together this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much that we could come here to your church and worship today, and we want to ask you now to please fill our hearts, our minds, this church, both inside and out. Please fill it with your Spirit and your holy angels. And please help our minds to be focused on what you want us to learn today. And please help us to be able to understand the truths and also that we can share them with others as opportunities arise. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Good job bearing the freezing weather today. We'll just keep springing our hearts for right now. Our first song today is going to be 305, Give Me Jesus.
In the morning when
one of my favorite songs. Our next one is going to be 462, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Should definitely praise him all day long. If you want to stand and join me for our opening hymn, number 358, Far and Near, the Fields Are Teeming.
Far and near, their gold is gleaming o'er
be seated.
Isn't it good to open with song? It certainly is. It uplifts me. I want to welcome each of you to our Sabbath services today, and those who are live streaming, welcome also. I know that each of us have special prayers that we want to lift up to God, don't we? Each and every day we do. Let's, those of us who can, kneel with me as we have our morning prayer. Dear God, what a privilege it is to come and petition to you for all the needs and the cares that we have, because you hear each one of them. Dear Father, I pray for the illness of people. You know their conditions, you know the circumstances. I pray that you'd send the Holy Spirit's healing hand to be upon them, and especially be with our sister Margaret. She's not feeling well today. I pray that you would bless her, and we lift her up to you. I pray that you would be with all of our families, that they would turn their hearts to you and want to be with you in heaven. Dear God, help each of us to be there also. Help us to make that decision that will allow you to cover us with your grace. Bless Lee as he brings the message to us today. May it be uplifting and encouraging, and may we go away refreshed, knowing that we've been with you, is my prayer in thy name. Amen. Danielle will now bring the children's story. Children, if you'd go get your baskets, it's time for children's story.
There's going to be a really good story today. We have one, and I see more of you. Young at heart, too. Good morning, boys and girls. We'll wait for Hudson.
Good
Okay, so today I have a story, a very special story, about obedience. Do you know what obedience means? What does obedience mean?
To be honest.
To be honest? Not quite. Obedience means to obey, to do what you're told, right? Are you supposed to obey your parents? Yeah, and part of obedience is listening. So you gotta listen and do what you're told. You have to be honest about that. So my boy, when he was about 3 years old, didn't always listen. And he's not here today. He's in a church in Colorado today. So I told him yesterday I was going to tell this story. He said, "Mom," and I said, "Well, you won't be there, so by the time you come back to our church, everyone will forget." So we'll see if that's true. But I hope you remember the lesson. So he was a very energetic child, and I had a special chair in our living room. This is what it looked like. It's a lazy boy chair, okay? So it rocks, and the feet go up. Well, it was sitting right next to my desk, and I was sitting at my desk working on some stuff, and he was just kind of standing up and sliding down the back of the chair. Now, I usually don't allow even standing on furniture, but he was there, he was happy, he was being good, and he wasn't jumping. I don't want him jumping on the furniture. Well, sliding down ended up being boring, and so a little bounce started to be created while he was sliding down the back of the chair. And I kind of noticed, I was like, eh, he's still okay. And he'd jump a little bit harder and a little bit higher and a little bit harder, a little bit higher. And I said, "You need to stop that. We don't jump on the couch or on the chair." And he just kind of looked at me and jumped one more time. Should we obey right when our parents tell us to do something? Yes, and you know what? He didn't. He jumped one more time. Well, right next to that chair, I had a kerosene heater, a ribbed kerosene heater, sitting right next to. It was not on because it was being stored next to the chair right then. And he jumped, and he missed the back of the chair. He went towards the arm of the chair, right next to the heater. And his head hit the heater. And you see those ribs on it? That's metal. Does metal and skin go well together? No, it doesn't. And he screamed. And I obviously ran to him. Thankfully, I was right next to him. And I grabbed him in my arms and I held him close. And I felt something trickling down my hand that was on the back of his head. What do you think that was? Blood. He had split his head open. Now, just the skin, praise the Lord, the bone was all still intact. But I had to take him to the emergency room because I didn't know how bad it was. And I was thinking, I was home alone, and I was going, how am I going to get him to the hospital with his head bleeding? Because fingers and heads bleed the worst, and they don't like to stop bleeding. And so I was going, how am I going to get him without getting blood everywhere? And I started praying. I said, "Jesus, please help this bleeding to stop." You know, within 5 minutes, the bleeding had completely stopped. That's really fast for a head wound. And I quick threw him in his car seat, and I took him down to the hospital. His daddy met me there, and we got in there, and they were looking at him. He was laughing. He was smiling. He was talking. And they're like, "Is something wrong with this kid? Like, why are you here?" I was like, "He split his head open." And the doctor's looking at him. He's going, "We're going to need staples." Do you know what staples are? Yeah, they're metal piece, right, that usually keeps, like, papers together. Well, they have special ones for people. And I just about passed out. I don't do well with things like that. And I was like, a staple, are you sure he needs a staple? And the doctor's looking at it, and he's sitting there. He's pinching the skin around the ouchie. And I'm about ready to pass out because my child is hurt and you're messing with him. And you're going to put a staple in his head. And the doctor goes, you know what? The skin's giving enough. We can glue it shut. And I'm going, glue? What are you thinking this is? And so he did. He glued the spot, and I have a picture here. It's not bad. Of his head, being glued. There's the glue in his head, and it's blue. It's blue glue. And so once that dried up, it turned blue as it dried. And eventually it just worked its way out. The skin behind it healed behind it. And I eventually was able to cut the glue out of his hair without having any issues. And he was fine. There was no concussion. I was so thankful. But did he obey me? No. Did he get hurt? Yes. Could it have been worse? Yes. So God's angels were still protecting him as he was learning lessons about obeying. But do we always obey? Do we always obey God? You know, we're told that if we learn to obey our parents, as we get older, we will learn to obey God. Does God have special rules for us, like don't jump on the couch? They're a little more special than that, aren't they? God says, honor your mother and your father. That means obeying them so that you can live long in the land that the Lord your God gives you. And that's not just living here on this earth. He's talking about living with him in heaven. Because if you learn to obey your parents here, you will learn to obey God. And then you can go to heaven. And that is what is so special. That's why we need to learn to obey. And God is so loving that even when we disobey, he tries to protect us. But sometimes we still have to deal with consequences, like blue glue in our hair. And to this day, if Benjamin's hair is cut short enough, you can still see the scar on the back of his head. And, you know, we have to remember that sometimes when we make bad choices, we still have scars. We can still have scars. But you know what? Jesus has the biggest scars that were left because of our disobedience. So let's remember to obey and love Jesus, and let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for loving us so much, for giving us the Ten Commandments so that we know how to obey you, because you want to protect us, just like our mommies and daddies who love us so much. You love us even more, and you pay the ultimate consequence for our sins. You died for us. And Lord, we thank you for always loving and protecting us, even when we don't realize we need it. Be with us today. Help us to listen and be quiet during the church service so that we can hear your words. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You can go back to your seats.
Our offering today is for the Rocky Mountain Conference. You know, they support our education heavily. And I'm so thankful for that, because with a school here and teachers, we need their support, don't we? Would the deacons please stand? Dear God, I pray that you'd bless this offering, that it would further the education in our conference and bring others to you. Guide us with this, dear Father, and may we remember our ties along with this. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for being there for us whenever we need you, is my prayer in thy name. Amen. Thank you. Our scripture this morning is 1 Samuel 14:7. 1 Samuel 14:7. So his armor bearer said to him, "Do all that is in your heart. Go then. Here am I with you, according to your heart." Our special music this morning is by Mariah and Tammy. Last week, I was here early, as Chalky and I always are on Sabbath morning, and Mariah had come with Chalky, and I'm kidding her. "Well, are you singing today?" And she says, "No." So I opened up the bulletin, and I said, "Well, it says here you're singing today." And you should have seen the look on her face. It was a mistake, but thankfully, Tammy and Mariah are singing for us today.
Happy Sabbath. So the song that we're going to do today is going to be an a cappella, and it's based on a true story that Dolly Parton went through in her childhood. You ready?
Back through the years I go wandering once again. Back to the seasons of my youth. I recall a box of rags that someone gave us, and how my mama put the rags to use.
There were rags of many colors, and every piece was small, and I didn't have a coat, and it was way down in the fall. Mama sewed the rags together, sewing every piece with love. She made my coat of many colors that I was so proud of.
And as she sewed, she told a story from the Bible she had read, about a coat of many colors Joseph wore, and then she said, "Perhaps this coat will bring you good luck and happiness." And I just couldn't wait to wear it, and Mama blessed it with a kiss. My coat of many colors that my mama made for me, made only from rags, but I wore it so proudly. Although we had no money, I was rich as I could be. In my coat of many colors my mama made for me.
So with patches on my breeches and holes in both my shoes, in my coat of many colors I hurried off to school, just to find the others laughing and making fun of me. In my coat of many colors my mama made for me.
And though I couldn't understand it, for I felt I was rich, and I told them of the love my mama sewed in every stitch. And I told them all the story mama told me while she sewed, and how my coat of many colors was worth more than all their clothes. But they didn't understand it, and I tried to make them see that one is only poor, only if they choose to be. Now I know we had no money, but I was rich as I could be. In my coat of many colors my mama made for me, made just for me.
It was worth waiting for, wasn't it? Lee, tell us about your favorite Bible hero.
I enjoyed that. Did you?
Yes.
Very much. Also enjoyed the little guy down here, too. Please pray with me as we begin. Heavenly Father, please may your Spirit come. Fill this house, our hearts, and my mouth with your message. To your glory, I ask. Amen. I have a confession this morning. I and the computer at home have had some tiffs recently. Each time I revised this, it came out in a different format, and I can't tell you why. I finally gave up. It won. As you know, the elders are following an agreed theme in sermon preparation for this quarter, which allows for more consistency in prep and presentation, while at the same time allowing each presenter the opportunity to focus on subjects or people that have special meaning. This quarter, the presentations have centered on the Beatitudes, Speaker's Choice, and Bible Heroes. As you think about the heroes described in Scripture, which ones rise to being the level of a hero in your eyes? What qualities impressed you the most? Did you find yourself wanting to have some of their qualities and become like them? I became fascinated with a group or class of people who provided specialized, individualized service for key people in high-ranking leadership positions. These individuals are called armor bearers. Our text this morning, 1 Samuel chapter 14, verse 6 is one of those people. There are several others. By the way, accounts of armor bearers are only present in the Old Testament. There's none in the New by illustration. But we'll come to that in a little bit. Armor bearers had special responsibilities. The Greek phrase ho eron ta skou, literally the one carrying the armor. These were people who carried a large shield and weapons for a king that was going into battle. Some of the people who had armor bearers were Abimelech, King Saul, Saul's armor bearer and Jonathan's armor bearer are just a few that are mentioned. Some of the names were Abner, Jonathan, and Hur. Each of these men carried a large shield and other weapons during a battle. Battle weapons included a shield, and I was going to try and bring some of these, but obviously it didn't work out. A sword, a bow and arrow, a sling, a spear, an axe, a dagger, heavy armor, and a helmet. Can you imagine going into battle carrying all of these things? Not with my physique would I be able to do that. Qualities of armor bearers were many. And you'll pardon me while I get into the note part of my disorganized presentation. An armor bearer had actually 11 functions to perform. He was to protect the king, protect other warriors, carry the king's shield, carry the king's weapons, protect the king's body, relay messages from the king to other warriors, relay messages from other warriors to the king, give food and water to the king and other warriors, help injured warriors, take care of the horses and chariots, and carry supplies. You think he was a busy person? He had a lot of areas to cover. And by the way, keep these things in mind, if you would, please. Bow and arrow was a very popular weapon. A sling was a leather pouch that a warrior could carry and place stones in. Imagine carrying a spear that you would throw at the horses from the challenging group. Carrying a sword, what would you do with a sword? You'd use it, wouldn't you? An axe. You know what an axe looks like? A dagger, the shield. By the way, these shields were huge, very large. Body armor and a helmet. Most of the time, they carried the shields and the spear. Some armor bearers probably did not fight alongside their master in the battle, but they were the in-between person who had a lot of other things to try to keep up with. Is there any parallel between Old Testament armor bearers and armor bearers in today's world, in our churches, and in this one? Do we have a need for armor bearers here now? I would subscribe that we do. Who are they? Anyone serving in a leadership capacity, in my opinion, and I would suggest strongly, is an armor bearer. Who are people that we need to support?
Our pastor.
Our pastor. Anyone else?
Church leader.
All church leaders. What does it mean to be an armor bearer in today's world?
Support.
How do we support?
Encouragement.
Encouragement.
Pray for them.
Pray for them.
Example.
Does it mean that all people in leadership positions never make a mistake? We all do. We all do. And sometimes we eat our words that were hastily spoken. I'm talking about myself. I get tired of hearing myself. What kind of qualities do we need in armor bearers? And by the way, are we just talking about leadership? No, folks, this fits all of us. What are an armor bearer's responsibilities? This list put me on my knees. Do I have these kind of qualities? I pray so. I pray that you do too. Be available. If someone needs you, be available. Be in a position to present spiritually, mentally, and emotionally the qualities. You must show up and be alert and be spiritually in tune and emotionally stable and intact. Be willing to help. Your willingness to serve goes a long way. There are people in various roles, but their heart is not willing, and their attitude reflects it. Skill is great, but when service comes out of a begrudging, hating to have to serve heart, it taints the gift even when coming from the most skillful. Look at 2 Corinthians 8, 10 to 12. Understand and respect boundaries. Can you be trusted? Can I be trusted? Relationships take time to establish. sometimes months or years, to build the trust that's needed right at that moment. The heart of a servant is patient and long-suffering. What about being sensitive to the needs of other people? I've had to learn that not everybody else is at the same point in their relationship with Jesus that I may or may not be. So it's not up to me to judge anyone else. Take the focus off of me and search where you can serve others. Be approachable. Romans 12:3. Be kind, friendly, and non-judgmental. Can we do that given the list of qualities that a Christian should possess? Do you have a genuine interest in other people? Good morning, Brother Jones. Brother Jones is over here. I don't have contact with Brother Jones because I'm really not interested in what's happening in his life. So I have just said to Brother Jones, what I've just said is a formality, and I don't care about you or what's happening to you. Am I honest? Can I give honest and helpful counsel to someone unless I care? Not as a meddling, inappropriate person who says, you got to do it the way I say, without giving him or her the opportunity to be an individual and have their own relationship with Christ. I cannot describe the agony that this sermon preparation has caused me to think about the opportunities that I have missed in the past by trying to get somebody else to do things the way I thought they should do it, without allowing Jesus to be present and guide them in their own experience. I do not mean this today to be a lecture. It's a confession. And I ask some simple questions. This will be a short sermon this morning. Who walks into the battle with you? As you lead yourself and your family in your spiritual walk. In turn, who are you an armor bearer for in their spiritual walk? Who are you a prayer warrior for? Do you have a prayer warrior? Do you? Who are you watching out for, encouraging, and giving help to think about it. Let me repeat the question again. Who are you watching out for, encouraging, and giving guidance to? The role of an armor bearer is not for the weak-hearted, the selfish, or the disinterested. If you don't care, don't go there. It takes a special person who is committed to the Lord first and then to fellow believers. Every person here this morning can be an armor bearer. If you know someone that's having a struggle, don't kick them down. They're down far enough. They need you, but they also need someone else that's stronger than you. Who is that person? Jesus. I found a text. Revelation 22, verse 4. We know this text. We've read it many times. They shall see His face, and His name shall be on their foreheads. Who is this talking about? It's talking about our leaders, but who is the person? It says they shall see His face. Whose face? The face of Jesus. Folks, if we forget everything else, when we go through those doors this morning, what we are asked to do is to let the face of Jesus be what people see and the voice that they hear all the time. Not mine, not mine. The face of Jesus. No matter what the problem is, people need that connection. We need the connection. We cannot share something we don't have. Maybe you can. But I can't. So please, this morning, as we sing our closing song and go through those doors, it's the face and the voice of Jesus that we need to share with other people. No matter who the issue is with, or what, let them see Jesus.
If you all want to stand with me and we'll sing our closing hymn, 330, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my life.
Heavenly Father, may your voice, your face, and everything about you be what we take from us today, from this place. Strengthen us, Lord. Help us to show the world what living with Jesus really means and how it changes us into your likeness. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.